pickup
Sure.
to know fine tune their skills and
Right.
orient themselves towards entrepreneurship. Right,
Yep.
sir. With that note, sir, over to you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, and good morning to all of you. Nice to meet you again. We had a discussion last week on design thinking, and connecting again with all of you is very nice. So, as Dr. Shivkiran said, there are many, many tools, in fact, thousands of tools out there. And as simple as the way he talked about problem identification, I think the same thing applies a lot in terms of usage of tools as well. So, do you use a tool just for the sake of using it because everyone is using, or because you need to use it? So, that's something which lies at the crux of the using a tool. And let me start by saying that it's not necessary to use any tool if you think that your system works fine. But there are many places where a tool helps you do better, helps you connect with other people who could be relevant for you. And it also frees up your time. I think this is something which is important for an entrepreneur, because when you're looking at a business owner or someone who is setting up a business, they have a lot of things to do. So we are looking at typically people who start as an individual or a team of one or two people, and they do everything, right from the head of the business to being someone who gets tea. I think that's the typical life of an entrepreneur when he starts, or he or she starts off. And as they grow and as their idea or product or service picks up, then they get some luxury to invest in facilities or people who can work for them. And as the team grows, then things evolve. But there are tools which remain with you always, because these are generic tools which improve the way you work. So the way I have thought of this whole session is, let me talk about tools in two categories. One is, what does the entrepreneur as an individual needs as a tool? So we will talk about, what are digital tools and why do we really need them, and where is it that an individual needs them, and what kind of tools are available. The second portion, I would want to talk about the tools which a business needs. So we will talk in terms of, what does the teams require in a business? What do you need to ensure that your digital presence is there, or that you're managing your day-to-day functions or your administration, finance? So we will deep dive into a couple of tools. I also want to restrict my delivery to very less time, but would want to take you through a couple of tools, because I think that will make more sense rather than me just theoretically talking about 1 to 100 tools. So I will show you a couple of slides where we will talk about the basics and the why and how of things. And then I will actually take you through a few tools which I personally use, and some of them which I don't use, but may be useful for you or for the students you teach, the entrepreneurs you handle. Okay, so let me start by asking you a question first of all. Can you think of the digital tools which you all use at the moment? And just put them on chat, any tools which you use, and then we will see for what purpose you use them. So just pick up one or two names, each of you. You can put on chat. It doesn't matter for what purpose you're using, but just put names of some tools, and then we will talk about one. WordPress, Grammarly, yes. Okay, mobile computer. Ma'am, can you describe it a little more? When you say mobile computer, is it a app or is it a software? Like, what it is? If you can just quickly add one or two words. Okay, Moodle. Some more, please. I'm sure we all have huge number of apps and tools on our phones and our laptops, and we use many of them. Canvanizer, yes. Few more. So it'll help me get a sense of what you are already aware of, and what you're already using, so that we can focus on Evernote. Yeah. Okay. So wonderful. So the kind of apps which you have written, five or six which I've got, are either related to creating and saving content. So basically WordPress also doubles up as a website creator. We have Grammarly, which helps us, you know, create better content in terms of writing. Yes, sir, Google Suite. Google Suite is something which is very versatile, and we'll talk about a couple of other suites as well. Evernote again helps in terms of documenting your notes, you know, a to-do list, you can schedule your day, many other things. Screen-O-Matic, yes, for recording your screen and again creating content and sharing it with others. So what is it that we are talking about when we say digital tools? And if you see that it took you some time to even think of some tools, because they become so much part of our life that we don't even think of them. Right, we use something like a WhatsApp, which many of you have not mentioned. It's actually a digital communication tool, a social media tool, not only for connecting with people to say good morning, but WhatsApp in India at least is one of the most used tools for forums. So where people create informal groups, there are focus groups of people for conducting meetings, they do WhatsApp calls, there are storytelling groups on WhatsApp, there are groups of entrepreneurs, alumni, what not. You know, that's a tool which has become a part of our life, and we don't really feel that it is separate from us, because every phone now comes you know, enabled for WhatsApp, right? Another tool which we all have been using, and many of people have started using even before the digital thing was forced upon us, is a calling tool like Duo. So Google Duo, I had seen people using even as long as, you know, 2 years back when it had just been introduced, I think 2-3 years back, and people had started using it for group calling. So my family members used to call on Duo because it takes very light bandwidth. So these tools are here to stay, and the preferences of tools differs. So each of us may like a particular tool. Now there are people who, you know, swear by Telegram as compared to WhatsApp because it has a larger capacity for group. And it seems to have less bells and whistles, you know, it's much more easier to handle, and you can add as many people as you want and share things. So let's go into it and start thinking about what exactly do we mean by digital tool. Let me give you a very quick kind of a practical definition, and there would be many other technical and other definitions which you can come across. But I'll just talk about, you know, something which works in terms of. So what do we mean by digital? Primarily, there are four things which I talk about when we talk about a digital tool, just to ensure that we are not confusing it with something. So it is something which is not physical. So we are talking about something which exists in ones and zeros. It's you know, not an analog thing, but something physical and in the digital space, which can be coded, which can be presented through a device, which we'll talk about. Anything when we mean by digital, it has to deal with data and information in some way. So either it should be receiving, sending data, it should be processing data, it should be visualizing it, storing it, organizing it, some form of data. And data could be anything. It could be text, it could be numbers, it could be images, videos, audios, whatever we're talking about, you know. So basically any form of data. So that's why when we say a voice call is not necessarily a digital thing, because it contains of only the, you know, magnetic or electrical impulses and signals. So we're not talking about that as a digital tool. So a voice calling tool is a basic functionality of a phone, which used to exist even in earlier times. The third important feature is the device. So a digital tool is something which can run on a digital device, a laptop, a computer, or a pad, or a phone, you know, digital smartphone as we talk about. And obviously it has to work using different platforms. So it could be run on a browser, or it could be in form of an application, which can be either downloaded on a laptop or on a phone, right? So we are agnostic here in terms of the operating systems or not, because once we talk about digital, it obviously means some kind of operating system, because otherwise the machines don't run. So we're not going to worry about that, because the moment we get into iOS versus Android or Microsoft versus Macintosh, we get into a much bigger territory and the tools differ and vary. So I'm going to focus more on the generic tools, which are mostly available on all the platforms across operating systems, so that we don't, but there are certain tools which work only on a Apple device, and they don't work on other operating systems. And there are many other tools which are primarily made for Microsoft or others, and they don't function as well on other operating systems. So what I would want is, because this is more of a free discussion, I would request all of you to keep putting your questions, or there is also a feature, because the Zoom, when you go to participant list at the bottom, there is something called raise hand. So at any point of time, if you feel that you want me to stop or answer a question and you don't want to put it on chat, just use raise hand feature and we'll be good to go. Okay. So let's put the tools in form of why do we need them? Okay. I talked about some of the things. So any tool for that matter, let's not get into digital, but any tool helps us increase our productivity, you know? So think of the early human life where stone instruments were used as tools for either breaking things or for carving things out. And now as we move to the high-end technical tools, which are made of chromium or titanium or these kind of things, which cannot get spoiled over long times, how they are more effective and efficient. So productivity increases the moment we upgrade the tools, and digital tools help us increase productivity because they increase the speed of processing. They increase the way we work, and many of the things, are done better than what a human being would do. Okay. They are flexible, so you can use them anytime, any place. If you are at home, as we are working at the moment, if you are in an office, if you are at a client site, especially entrepreneurs who will need to travel a lot, if they are in businesses which require meeting people too frequently or going to product, road shows or events. So flexibility, you can work anytime, any place. Accessibility, so you can access from multiple devices. So if there is a tool which is available across devices, that's much better as compared to a tool which works only on a particular platform or a particular device. Many of these digital tools are actually available for free if you're using a basic version, which is what typically an entrepreneur needs at the beginning of their journey. You don't need to really go into a hi-fi ERP system or a full-fledged product suite to begin with. Most of the work can be done actually using almost all the free tools. At times you need to go for some of the licenses which are very economical. So it's like pay-per-use, how many users you have, depending on that, email packages are available, or you can create a website and scale it up as you have more and more users. Or e-commerce side. Similarly, when you're going for payment gateways or things like that, you can actually go for connectivity with your bank, and you pay only when you receive payments. So those kind of things are possible. And the choice, there's a huge variety of tools in every category you think about. From the very basic tool, like a meeting platform, which we are using here, Zoom. You know the kind of variety which exists in that. For each kind of user, there is a different platform. And I'm told that you have already used many of the platforms for these sessions, so you would be aware of something like AirMeet or what we have in BlueJeans, or the Zoom, or the Zoho platform, which we used last time, Adobe, and so many others. So the flexibility and choice in terms of choosing what suits you is there in terms of digital tools which you need. They are easily available. You can download a tool in a moment and start using it. So that again gives you that accessibility and ease of use. So that's why the need there is, because it helps you do all of this with very less expense. See, one of the critical things for an entrepreneur initially is to ensure that the costs are maintained. While you focus on revenue and business, you also take care of the cost. So in fact, if you have read the book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, there is a follow-up book which he says, which talks about, I think the name of the book is Before You Leave Your Job. I think that's the title, Before You Quit Your Job. So there he talks about a very important concept for a business owner. He says that any expense you make, first make an entry against it as to what it is going to earn for you. So this becomes especially true when you see a fancy tool and you feel like subscribing to it. Is it going to serve your purpose? Is it going to reduce cost for you? Is it going to increase revenue for you? Is it going to make your process more efficient? Is it going to bring you closer to customer? I think these are the thoughts which first have to come up. We'll talk about all those later. Okay, so as I said, a business owner does almost everything in the beginning, right? They don't have the liberty to, outsource too many things. They start by doing. So there are two critical functions I feel as a business owner, and I have been one for last 10 years, so I can relate to these. And what I'm saying here is a lot from my own experience. So there are things where you just need to maintain your day-to-day stuff. You don't need to really do anything extra. So if there is something going on and someone else is doing it, you just need to monitor it. If there is something which you don't have to do, you delegate if you have a team or if you want to give it outside. And there are things which you just manage in terms of asking for updates, in terms of, you know, sending a mail or scheduling something. So these are some of the basic maintenance functions which a business owner does on a day-to-day basis. But there are a lot of things which a business owner will do to take the business ahead. And these are the critical things, because one trap is for a business owner to fall in the kind of feeling that they are doing a lot because the day is full. They get up at 5 and they sleep at 11 o'clock in the night. But what is it they are using that time for is critical. So a lot of time has to go in terms of moving ahead related activities. What is it that they're creating? So when it comes to decision making, when it comes to designing a product, when it comes to taking, you know, kind of a step forward in terms of meeting a client, in terms of setting an agenda, I think that takes your company forward. Looking at what is market, asking for, talking to customers. These are the things which create. So creation does not necessarily mean, making a new service or a product. Creation means what is the opportunity you're creating for your business? What are you doing to take it ahead? The second thing is important to continuously read and listen. So much is being done across the world. And if you're not reading what other people are saying, some of the leaders in business, whether it's Elon Musk or whether you talk about Bill Gates or even some other entrepreneurs who have been in the past, like Richard Branson, these are the people who have been pioneers, who have thought of industries which no one thought of earlier. So we need to keep reading. There is so much now, so many podcasts available now which you can listen on the go. You don't need to be really sitting on your desk and doing it. When you're traveling, you can listen to it. So reading and listening is a critical part of a business owner's activity, and they should set aside time for it. The third important thing is to learn every day. What are you learning? What is your customer saying? Are you learning something from it? Are you implementing or changing things? Or are you feeling that your product is the best? So, it doesn't matter. Are you learning from what your competition is saying? Are you learning from what is happening in other industries which may impact you? For example, when we last time we were talking about the iPod and iPhone. So audio cassettes and Walkmans used to be the way of the world before the digital music came in. Did anyone even think? I still own a Walkman, by the way. I have a Walkman. Everyone used to have one. And no one ever thought that music would go digital. And today we don't bother to download music. That's a kind of shift. We used to get the cassettes recorded, and today we can just listen to them, stream them online. So are you aware what is happening in the industry, in the domain, which may impact you, if not today, but 2 years or 3 years down the line? So can it push you out of the business? So I was reading, something very interesting yesterday, and I don't remember who said this. He said, if you're planning something for 3 years, then you are going to have a huge competition. But if you're planning something for 7 to 10 years, then there will be no one to compete with you. So that is the kind of thing you have to look ahead. What are banks doing today? You don't need someone from media and banking, right? But banks are hiring those people. Why? Because these people have experience of understanding the viewership. They know how to see what content people are liking. They know how to present that content to those kind of people so that there is more viewership, more people, more advertising revenue. So banks are using these people to engage their audience digitally. Banks are hiring people from telecom to do better customer service, because telecom is an industry which has huge customer base and kind of maximum complaints. How do they handle these complaints? What kind of systems have they evolved? So if you think back, and I'm sure you would have all experienced, phone banking came into the banking scenario long back. I think it was introduced in India by most of the foreign banks, Citibank or Standard Chartered or these kind of things. But the way Indian banks have now adapted to moving on to a, you know, voice bot based service, where you don't even need to talk to a human, but you don't realize it. There are AI and machine learning. So how these artificial intelligence and machine learning has been adapted into banking to make the customer service more efficient. So learning is a critical part of an entrepreneur's day-to-day life. They have to learn and they have to network. They need to talk to people who are in the same industry. They need to talk to the industry leaders. They need to know what people are writing about. They need to understand. And networking helps in multiple ways. One, people see you. So you create visibility. You see others. So it helps you know what is happening around. Three, it helps you create a connect which can be good for you in future in terms of generating business. So these four activities are critical for any business owner to move ahead. And I feel a business owner should focus on apps or tools which will help them do these on a day-to-day basis, because there are a lot many other things which a business needs, which will come to later, which they will have access to. But these are some things which they need to do. Okay, I have something on chat, I guess. So let me just have a look quickly. Give me a moment. Okay, so I have seeing a tree in the seed is what Dr. Shapiran says. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
I was referring to that, you know, 10 years down the line, like your futuristic thing should be able to visualize that.
Right. And as you rightly, you were pointing out at the beginning, see, it's identifying the problem is the key here. When we are, many a times we try to solve the symptoms, you know, we just look at the top and say, okay, this is the issue and let's solve it. But that's where there is huge competition because everyone sees that. So a visionary entrepreneur is one who can go to the root and identify this is the issue and that's where can solve. So the diaper example, which I gave in the design thinking, you know, it's been 40 years and that Huggies is still one of the market leaders because they went to the root and identified what the key issue was. You know, they could have just done a cosmetic change, but they didn't do. So I think that's the crux of the whole thing. Go to the root. Okay. So of all these, how do you manage so much? You know, that becomes a key challenge. So if you are a business owner, you have the same 24 hours, you still need to sleep and eat and do all the, you know, personal work. How do you manage? So the key to all this is planning and scheduling. That is the topmost thing which a business owner or all of us, in fact, need to do, because the way we are facing the challenge of the digital world with so much of information, you know, overload. Planning and scheduling is the topmost thing which we need to spend time on so that everything else can fall in place. So I'm going to focus a lot on some tools related to planning and scheduling. I'll try to show you some of these tools and take you through how they work. Some of you may be using them and some of you may want to use them in future. So let me just showcase a couple of tools. Let me just first talk about what are the tools which I have listed. So I have just listed three tools in each category. Because if I tried to, you know, list all of them, it would have been a humongous task and we would need a couple of hundred slides. So I will just focus on three of each category, which are really popular and which are used by a lot of people. And there are reasons why they are good. Okay, so you will find them really useful. So planning, scheduling, there are three tools which are very commonly used. Any.do is a wonderful tool, which so the reason I picked up these tools are they work across platforms, they work across devices, and most of them have a free version. So you don't need to really pay for them when you're starting off. As you go ahead and when you want to use more and more features of these tools, that's when you get into a payment mode. So always start without having to pay and then move into a mode where you can afford to spend more and learn more from it. So AnyDo, Trello is a good planning and scheduling tool. And also it works in terms of a bit of project scheduling where people can work together on it. Todoist is one platform which is highly recommended by David Allen. David Allen is the writer of the book, Getting Things Done. I'm sure you would all have heard of GTD. Getting Things Done is one of the most, quoted book in terms of scheduling and planning, because he talks about one of the simplest possible method to schedule your day. So if you have not gone through it, I think there is a short book review available on YouTube, which is just about 10 minutes odd, which explains the whole concept of getting things done in 10 minutes. And there are a lot of articles. I can also share a couple of links if you want after we are done with this session. That's one book which I think everyone should read, every human being, because it simplifies planning process and tells you how what makes sense, you know. So let me go through the next kind of tools, which are the notes taking tools. Now, where do you need a note taking tool? As a business owner, you need to take information and organize it in some way, which can be useful for you. And that's where the note taking tool come into play. If you are in a meeting, let's say, and you want to note down things, you can always use a pen and paper. But a pen and paper can get lost over a period of time. So it's always good to use an electronic tool where the things can be saved for future. And you will not believe there are notes which I have taken 5-6 years back, which suddenly become relevant today, because you know, I've saved it somewhere. So one or two things which I use Evernote a lot for is when I'm reading on web some article and I need to save that article. There is a simple add-on onto Chrome or Internet Explorer or even on Edge. You can just click on that and it clips the whole article and puts it in Evernote for future. And within Evernote, then I can highlight it. I can mark the important words. You know, I can add my own comments there. A lot of things can be done. Workflow is a much simpler tool as compared to Evernote. It's a simple list making tool, actually, but with a lot of versatility. So you can make lists with tags. You can put dates. You can, you know, add categories. You can even put a reminder in Workflow. So all that and a much simpler interface. I'll just show you once we're done with this slide. Notion is a competitor to Evernote, and compared to Evernote, it has almost same feature, but I don't think it has a paid version. I'm not sure about it. Not a free version, sorry. It's mostly paid. There are many other apps which have come recently. One is called Rome Research, and Rome Research has got very good reviews, but that again is as of now by invitation only. Okay. Networking and sharing. We all know about LinkedIn and Quora. I have found one platform, BizCircle, to be very good. So if you want to recommend, now BizCircle is actually a platform which is owned and co-owned rather by ICICI Bank. Okay. So it also gets you all the customers of ICICI Bank there. Plus, if you have an account with the bank, it also allows you to access many of their facilities right from the BizCircle platform in terms of whether you want credit or knowing about product or how things work. And they have wonderful forums where you can get information right from the stage of, you know, appointing an auditor or starting a business to very complex things like cloud storage and all. So there are all kinds of small and medium enterprise and mid-level businesses on BizCircle. So it's a very good platform and forum for especially startups. Okay, when I come to reading, I have classified this into two separate categories. One is articles and one is books. Now, these three, Feedly, Old Reader, News Blur, are basically aggregation tools, you know, just like Google. Now, Google, if you search something, what it does basically is it uses an algorithm and picks up things from various places and shows you on one screen. So it basically searches and aggregates and organizes stuff for you. Now, Feedly, Old Reader, and all these are news aggregation tools. So you can put a URL in Feedly, and as things get published on that particular URL, it'll appear on your Feedly screen. So you don't need to go to 10 sites if you want to follow them. You can have just one Feedly where all the things will appear. You can choose what to read, what to skip, depending on the headline in the content. So it gives you it's like a magazine, which does all the work for you. All you need to do is to go in that on a daily basis and read it. Same way OldReader and NewsBlur, they just have a variation of formats and how they present things. We don't have time to read all the books, right? But it helps to read summary of the books. So that's what tools like Blinkist and Story Shorts, InstaRead work. What they do is they have a huge collection of books for which they have created summaries, including audio summaries. So all you can do is you can choose a book. Let's say, suppose you wanted to read Getting Things Done and you don't want to really go through the whole 300 page book. You can listen to the summary of the book, or you can read a summary which will take you about 7 to 8 minutes or 10 minutes. Then once you have done it, and if you feel there is value, you can buy or read that book completely. So these platforms give you that ability to choose by just reading a summary, because it summarizes, it gives you the key points. It also puts in form of, certain bullets as to what is a takeaway from the book and who is it relevant for. So these are the platforms or tools which help you. Learning, obviously, we are all aware of Coursera, edX, and TED Talk. There's also something called Talks by Google, where also they have a lot of very good talks to listen to. And the good thing about Coursera also is that many of the courses are free if you don't want a certification. You know, Coursera and Udemy give you, Udemy in fact charges for everything, but they have certain free courses. But Coursera gives you a lot of courses for free, but they don't give you a certificate at the end of it. So if you want to learn primarily, you are fine to go with free courses, you know. But if you want a certification, you just have to pay, I think, 2000 or 2500 rupees per certification is what they charge. But if certification is not your concern, if learning is your concern, then it works perfectly fine. You don't have to pay a penny, right? Same with TED Talks. There are so much of wealth of information is available there that you can, use it. There are two tools which I don't use, but I've just mentioned it here. And some people have said that they are really good. So these are focus tools. So something called a momentum dash, or boomerang. Now what they do is they help once you've planned your day and you're focusing on, let's say, a project on a particular day, it helps you stay focused. So the moment you get a temptation to move to another website, let's say a Facebook or a YouTube, it immediately prompts you and says that, sir, you were supposed to do this today and you are moving to a site which is not relevant for you. This is very good for people who have multiple things to do on a particular day and they want to first focus 3-4 hours on one thing. So, you know, these kind of tools work very well. Boomerang is also equally good tool and it helps you do the same thing. So I'll just pause for a moment here if there are any questions or anything before I start showing you a couple of tools. So let's have some kind of, interaction going here and then we can see. Okay, Mr. Prasad is saying Swayam is better. Sir, what is that tool used for? If you can unmute and talk about it. Mr. Prasad Babu?
Sir.
Yeah.
Hello. Swayam is the learning portal, MOOCs, okay. MOOC learning portal, okay. By the government of India.
Oh, okay. Okay.
It is offering so many massive open online courses, sir, for learning.
Right. That's nice.
Even in the regional languages also.
Oh, that's wonderful. So I think it would be pretty useful for people, especially in different regions. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
This Swayam portal is done by this Ministry of Education. And yes. We have this NPTEL, okay. That is by AACTE, right. For technical education.
Okay. Thank you so much for sharing. Yeah.
So even Andhra Pradesh government commission rate of college education also recently designed a tool called LMS, CC LMS. For that also in the regional languages, in Telugu also, we are doing preparing the videos on the educational academic content.
Wonderful. Wow. Thank you so much. I would want to have a look at it. I've not seen it, but I would want to really go through it. But as I said, different tools work for different people. So I think we should keep sharing these. So if anyone else has any tool which you feel is better than what I've told, I think it should be shared because we learn from each other that way.
In fact, I am very addicted to InShots. InShots
is pretty good. Yeah.
I never knew the research behind that. Like 30 words. I mean, I never thought that in 1 minute, an average human being will read 60 words. Huh? I don't know, right. 1 second, 1 word, something like that. That's there.
60 words. Yeah. Yeah.
And you have a wonderful algorithm also.
Yeah. So InShot is also an aggregator, but a short news aggregator.
Yes, very short news. Yeah. If you feel like reading more than 1 minute, then there is a link below. You can go to the original site.
Absolutely. You can do that. True. So any other thoughts anyone has so far what we have covered in terms of, what do you feel about it? So let's have a quick 2 minutes pause. If there are any questions or anything you want to talk about before I show a couple of these tools which I mentioned. The reason I want to show you these tools is so that not only you get a sense of what it is, but when you talk to the entrepreneurs or students who want to get into business about this, you will be able to give them a sense of why they would be useful for them. So before we do that, I think we can have a quick chat.
In fact,
anyone wants to share?
Yeah. If anybody wants to share, please share. I can add later also. No problem. Yeah.
Or maybe you can add in if someone has any thoughts. They can also.
They can join in. Yeah, sure. So you are. I mean, though the topic is towards like how these tools can help entrepreneurs or the faculty members to organize things and improve their learning process. I am looking at it in a different angle. Even that itself is a problem. Most of these lists you have made, they have addressed something and they added some value to everything. You know, you said that Evernote. The way it's so easy that you just clip some information from a reading material and do that. If you want to do that in a, to open a Word document, copy and paste it. And the courtesy, what is that called, reference would not follow with that. Then again, I have to paste it separately. So this is going to take very curation becomes very important too.
Yes, absolutely. No, and the way I'll show Evernote, if some people had said that they use it already, I think Mr. Prasad had said Evernote allows you to organize content very nicely.
Correct.
And once you have copied something, it becomes editable. So you can actually add your comments in the things. So you can't do it on web when you're reading an article and if you want to remember something and highlight it, it doesn't work easily, which Evernote allows.
So in fact,
carry on.
Sorry. This is very popularly used by bloggers. If somebody wants to write on cooking, somebody wants to write on travelogue, or somebody wants to write on science and technology research. It's very easy for them because blogging itself is their career. So many of them.
True. It can be used for research. So I know many journalist friends who use this for research because, it helps connect data. So you may be researching on something today and a year down the line, you're working on something else and you want to connect things. It helps you get that thing out. Also, Evernote has a wonderful feature called where you can use handwriting. So a lot of people who are out and who are comfortable with using a stylus on their phone or their tab or whatever, they find it very useful in terms of scribbling data. So if you're sitting in a conference and you want to take note, you don't want to type, you can just write as if you're writing on a piece of paper and it gets saved. So, a lot of versatility is there. So let me just start showing. If there are any questions, please feel free to ask while I just try and show. So let me start with AnyDo first, because that's something which I wanted to talk about in terms of scheduling and other things. So let me show my browser. Okay. Okay, so this is a AnyDo tool, which I'm talking about. Now, see, this is a very simple tool in terms of what you have to do. It just asks you to create a task. Let me just show you by creating a dummy task. Very simple to use, free to use. Okay. And a couple of things which work in this. One is you can create. So here I've created something called lists. So I can create folders here where I want to put. So this is my, AnyDo is based on Alan's getting things done concept, wherein he says in folder and next action, if you're waiting for something and something which you want to do in future, but you're not going to do it. So that's a cold storage for me. So it allows you to create these folders. It also allows you to create tags. So let me just show you that first before. Okay. So you can create whatever tags you want. So if you're on this side, I put a compliance as a tag. If I'm working on a project, let's say video, I'm creating a video, I can make that. I'm writing a book, I've created that as a separate tag. So when I create a task which I want to do, I can put a particular tag so that I can even search by tag. So let's say if I'm searching on transformation workshop, it shows me when all I'm going to do something about it. If I put coaching, there is a schedule right through future, what I'm going to do on it. So basically how it works is in terms of creating not only tags and futures, but it also helps you organize it. Now, creating a task is simple. Just go to create a task, say what you want to do. So let's say this is sample. all I need to do this and I need to pick up a time. That's it. So what time when I want to do it, just put a time. The app is syncs on your phone. And the wonderful thing here is it can actually sync with your Google Calendar. If you use a Google Calendar, Google application, it will sync with your calendar instantly. So you don't need to really go to multiple places to check out. Everything can be here. So on your Google contact, if you have someone's birthday, which could be helpful for you to network, that will appear on your taskbar here. So it integrates both ways. And it helps you not only organize your stuff, you can see the way you want it. So if you want to see only 1 week, it will show you the next 7 days. Let me first remove this so that it becomes a little bigger. It can also show you what you're going to see in terms of all tasks. So whatever you have today, tomorrow, and all that. So same way, the other tool which I was talking about works in terms of Todoist is very similar, only the appearance is different. Now, why do you need to organize your day? I think that's something which an entrepreneur should think about. If there is very less to do, you don't need this tool to do it. You can just use a pen and paper. So a lot of people use a simple bulleting journal, you know, write on a piece of paper on that day what you're going to do that day. But there are, if there are multiple things which you're going to do and there are commitments which you want to keep up with, there are some routine stuff which you have to do, some accounting work you have to do, you have to follow up on payments. So what David Allen says, write everything as a to-do. Even if it is as small thing as saying that, you know, you have to go to PTM of your son. Write that also part of this because then it becomes a part of your day. Everything is part of your day. So when people talk about work and life, you know, they say it's as if the work is not part of life. But ultimately, it's one life where we are doing work as another part and family is another part. You're having leisure also in that. So the focus of getting things done is that everything appears in your to-do list in some form or other. And you tag it so that you know that you have to do that. Nothing gets missed out. So this is one of the tools which works very well. And as I said, it's free to use. And even a subscription-based tool is very, very cheap. I think it's about 800 rupees per year. But it's not at all expensive if someone wants to really get into using this. Okay, let me show you the other tool which I was talking about. Okay, let me go to, okay, this is the Evernote tool which I use for, and you can see the way information is organized on the left side. Basically, it creates a lot of notebooks. So you can put things like that. So I use it for all possible things. So I have, like, for example, legal and compliance, something which I read and I want to remember, I put them here. So what are the incorporation expenses? You know, what are the filing dates? Some things which I want to remember. So it helps in not only in terms of remembering, in terms of creating and storing the data, but organizing it. So just give me a moment. I have some issue in the terms of net. So you see, this is a way it helps me remember. I also have some, let's say if I have some business ideas, I can use not only these notebooks to create those ideas, but to save things which are from other different sources, you know, relevant to that. So I don't need to really write anything about it at the moment, but it helps me store an idea somewhere and some relevant information related to it. So basically what it does it anytime in future, when I want to rework this idea, I don't start from zero. I don't search for things at that point of time, you know? So another important thing which helps you do is what you call on the top, if you see here. So you can create a note, you can chat with you. If you have, let's say an organization of 4 or 5 people, you can create a note where people can work together. So it helps you collaborate through new chat. You can chat with other people. You can create a local notebook or you can create it on cloud. You can import stuff from outside and you can export your notebooks and send it to some other, you know, colleague who can take it. It allows you to print the data and all that. But one thing I want to show you is the feature of, let's say, highlighting. So if you want to remember something in a particular article, it allows you to highlight and bold it so that at any future point of time, you can see and check that out. It allows you to also create what you call a coding bracket. So if I'm writing an article and I want to remember this separately, it creates a code out of it. You know, that becomes a separate thing. this is an article from the web, so it can, I can even edit it. So I just downloaded it to show. So I can remove stuff which I don't want from the article and retain only what I want, which is something wonderful. So if I don't want the whole article, I just remove the stuff and keep 4 or 5 things. So let me just show you one example before we move ahead. So for example, I had read this book Mind Master, and I wanted to save some part of image from that book. This is a book by Vishwanathan Anand, where he talks about his lessons from chess and how he has applied it to life. So I wanted this image from that book to remember it. And I just took an image and, you know, copied, pasted it here. So not only can I type text, I can type image. If I want to go back to this in detail, I can remember it. So this is the kind of versatility which this offers. And the tags appear at the top. So I put a tag as chess and Vishwanathan Anand. So in future, if I read something else from Vishwanathan Anand and I want to filter it on him, I can see all the posts which are relevant to it. So this is a beautiful resource for not only reading and saving stuff, but in terms of thinking. We want to read something and you know, use it for future. Okay, let me just show you one or two more tools, and I think we are almost at the end of session one. So okay. Okay, let me show you that Feedly which I was talking about. So Feedly, this is Feedly basically. I use it for reading daily stuff. So you know how it helps is you can basically any source you want to read from, whether it's a magazine, a newspaper, a journal, or a particular author you want to talk about, anything you want to read, you can just add a link to it. Just give me a moment. Some net issue I'm facing. This again is a free version I am using. You don't have to really pay for it. So it allows you to see, for example, I've created a category called news, wherein I have 5 or 6 different sources from which I can get news. So I use this to see what appears in the paper. I don't need to read everything, but it gives me a glimpse of what is appearing in today. And you can subscribe, even you don't need to subscribe or link the whole newspaper. So I have only link to columns and opinion, the editorial part. So I cut out all the extra news which might distract me. So, you know, it focuses only on what is relevant for me. So I have something from, let's say, Paul Krugman, who writes on economics, global economics. So there are articles which appear from him. So it helps you categorize data. There is another folder which I call the ideas, where I have a lot of articles which appear from relevant to new ideas, what is happening. So there is something from Killer Startups. Now Killer Startups focuses on new technology startups, you know, what they are doing, what kind of new products are coming in market. So someone who wants to keep an eye on what is happening in the market, this is a wonderful place to use. So it helps you keep an eye. It helps you read what you want to read. It gives you a general idea. There's also something from TechCrunch. So you can choose what you want. You can even choose a subject. So if you don't know a particular, let me just show you. If you don't know a particular source from which to get an information, let's say you want something on design thinking. It'll give you the sources in which there is material from design thinking. You can choose which one to follow. And all you need to follow is to just click on that. Just click, it gives you an option to subscribe to it. That's it. It'll show you what kind of, you know, news appears and what kind of things they do. And you can just follow it, as simple as that. So every day, just 10 minutes, 15 minutes I spend on this. It gives a sense of what is happening. What do I want to read? What I don't want to read? Because what you get otherwise is too much of news. If you go to any particular website or try to do too many things. Yeah, Renuka, Mendeley is also research purpose. It helps. See, as I said, there will be thousands of easy for you to use and which serves your purpose. So these are tools which I'm showing, which are used and which are, you know, ranked very high in terms of a lot of entrepreneurs who use them. So that's why I'm showing these tools. But if you ask me, anything which works for you is good. So don't have to really follow any particular tool. Okay, let me also show you quickly something else. Okay, so this is what I was talking about is the tool called Workflowy. So Workflowy is just simple listing, but it allows you to tag dates. It allows you to create folders or tags by using @ and hashtag. So if you're not used to using them, it may become a little of challenge, but otherwise it's a very simple tool. Just as you would make a list on a piece of paper, it works like that. And this again is free tool. Can be synced across your phone. It can be synced across various devices. It also has a desktop application. So these are some of the tools. Let me also see what else I can quickly show you. So I'm not going into Coursera, edX and all. You already know about them. But let me show you Quora, because that is one thing Quora and BizCircle, which I feel you should encourage your people to go for. Okay, so this is the ICICI BizCircle. This is actually a tool which was developed by Global Linker, which ICICI has collaborated with. It gives you a thing at the top, you know, so you can create your profile of your company, you can put things, and then there is something called, you can write your own articles here and share it with others. But more importantly, there is this section called knowledge. You know, so see, this is what is shared by people who are in different industries. So you can see benefits of cloud adoption by SMEs. There are articles on, you know, appointment of auditors, realizing customers. You have something called hiring the right person for your team, customer service. So all kinds of information which could be relevant for a SME or a SMB or a startup appears here. And it can be very useful for an entrepreneur to just look at things at a glance and see what they want to see. And this is an Indian platform. So it helps you get information primarily related to the Indian environment, right? All kinds of information. You can even sort information. You can join groups. So if you are part of, you know, any particular industry or something, you can join them. So, you know, there are groups for retail. You have e-commerce sellers, marketing, agri products, food, beverage, digital, all kinds of groups. You can choose to join whichever group you want accordingly. You can list your products here. So if someone is interested, they can, you know, inquire and ask you about it. You can create offers. So if there is something you're selling and you want an offer to be created and people to know about it, you can do that. And they also have something called an online store, which where you need to connect with them in terms of, you can create an online offering of your product where people can actually buy it. And a payment gateway solution ICICI Bank offers, I think through RazorPay or something, they directly offer you that solution. So you can actually create your own e-commerce store right here on this platform without really having to create your own website or anything. You just need an account and you can start doing it. So this is a wonderful platform, and I personally feel very useful for all the people who are looking at, you know, creating businesses. Let me show you the other one which I was talking about. Okay. Meanwhile, any questions you have, please keep writing on the chat. Yeah.
Sir, sir, can I ask you a question, sir?
Yes, yes, yeah. Yeah, yeah, sure.
Sir, actually, we are always talking about the high level businesses and the large cap companies. But India is having small businesses. Most of the businesses are very small and medium scale, right?
Right, right.
So, but there were no feasible apps which are very useful for the small businesses, very small business. They use the contacts in the regular phone and the WhatsApp also. But there are no apps very relevant to their help, which are helpful for their businesses. So that's what I feel. So what would you say about that?
So what do you think is a challenge which these businesses face, which they need to solve using any app? So as I said at the beginning, see, if you remember, the first point which I made was that if your business does not need any tool or an app, you don't need to go for it. Because see, ideally, what you're talking about, if you say, let's say if I am based in a particular industrial area where all my business contacts are within that industrial area, I don't need to really go out and do anything. Correct. But if you are in a business, let's say you want to like the idea which Mr. Shivkiran was talking about in terms of a transportation or a logistics solution, then you need something to reach out to people, maybe not initially, but at a later stage. So each business will have a need which will be different, and they will have an app which will be suitable for them. So there is no single formula or an app which will fit for all the business. So if you talk about very small business, so let me give an example of a professional who is starting from home. Let's say it could be a software person, it could be an agri business, it could be someone, any business basically. Someone who is starting from their small town, what is it that person will need, basically? What do you think is the need of that particular business?
Like we already discussed, right? Scheduling and planning.
Right. So like, scheduling and planning, scheduling and planning can be done on a piece of paper also. It can be done on a whiteboard also. Correct. So if I am starting a business where I am doing only one kind of work whole day, then I don't need really to plan things. But as things grow, as a business owner, I do multiple things. So you can use any app or any tool which works for you. You can use a simple filing system which works for you, which is also a tool, but it's not a digital tool. But when we are talking about digital tools, we are talking about apps which are commonly available and used. And as you rightly said, many of the businesses may not find these relevant. But the point here is that at some stage, you are going to come to a situation or a need where you may want to use this. You may not use it on day one. So for example, if I talk about myself, when I started my business, I didn't use BizLinker. But I have started using it now because I do a lot of SME consulting and I find a good audience there on BizLinker. Earlier, I was doing it more through my own context. So the point here is, do you want to expand or do you want to remain in your own context is what you need to ask. So as an entrepreneur, which stage that person is in or which stage that particular product or service is in and what do they want to take it to? I think at that stage, you have to decide what app. But as you correctly said, many of these apps may not be relevant to some of the small businesses. Can you give me some examples of businesses which you want to talk about and let's figure out and see if some tools are available for them.
On a lighter note, see the vegetable vendors are the local small businesses.
Right.
See, vegetable vendors are using, they are doing business at a standard particular place only. So they won't sell their products even to the next street also. So that is the problem. Yeah. But in between, the Amazon and Flipkart, all these multinationals, even Jio, all these people are coming into the door, at the doorsteps of every house. So they are eating the small businesses. These people are affecting very badly. So if they use some kind of these kind of powerful tools or something like that, they may grow their business and so like that. So that's what.
But sir, they are already using it. I don't know how much which particular location you're talking about. our vegetable vendor already uses WhatsApp and delivers at home. You know, there are people, all of them use Paytm or some kind of a payment gateway to get payment. They are using either Google Pay or Paytm. They are already upscaling themselves. So while their area of operation is small, they are using these tools to get. In fact, I'll tell you something. One of the vegetable vendors in our locality he has created a WhatsApp broadcast group and he sends vegetable prices every day. So there are people who are using the tools which are available to go beyond what they are. So he is not in our particular locality, but this particular guy I'm talking about is about 2 to 3 kilometers away from our house. But once we had purchased from him and paid to him, and he has created a list and we are part of that list, and he sends it the price list every day. So I feel, there are two things which are critical. One is if a vegetable vendor is satisfied sitting at one place and selling to the captive customers, captive in the sense who come to him every day and buy from him or regularly, then it's fine because there is no growth in that. If someone is looking at expanding, the person can create another branch, as we call it, one part of a family member can create, or he can use the same setup and deliver anywhere within that locality within say 5 kilometer radius by using some of these tools. So I think it's lot to do with,
yes,
one is the scale to which the person desires to take the business, and then what is the tool required to take it to that. So it's a combination of that.
Thank you sir.
Yeah, most welcome. So your question was very interesting, but I'm already seeing a lot of such tools being used everywhere. In fact, to give you an example, the person who comes and cleans our car, he also doubles up as someone who gets franking done. So people are diversifying because once I asked him and he did franking and he accepts payments only through Google Pay. So people are moving up. They are using whatever tools are available. They are doing. So this person has contacts with a lot of banks for franking and he takes documents and gets them done. So what I'm trying to say is that there is possibility of using some tool or other which helps you. And there is no necessity to use the tool also. So it works either way. Yeah.
If I may add one point, sure. Sir, you were referring to the small SMEs, right? Even micro the one. I've seen there is something called Khata. How many of you seen Khata Book? It's an app.
Yeah, I've seen it. It's wonderful. It's very nice.
For money lenders, earlier Pygmy people used to be there. Such a big note used to be there. In every shop, they collect 20 rupees, 30 rupees, write down, take every day signature. Now Khata Book has come. If you want to give credit to someone of your known person in your own grocery nearby people,
true.
Take note of that. In fact, that there you can even send WhatsApp also.
Yeah.
And people also can look into Meesho.
Yeah,
Meesho is another tool. I mean, talking about the soft skills for people, but one of the participants raised this question about small medium enterprises, what tools they can use. You can look into Meesho, sir. How they have integrated WhatsApp into multi-layer marketing system.
In fact, sir, one thing also I want to add here: Facebook has emerged as one of very strong business tools. There are people who are doing wonderful business through Facebook. And I am aware of housewives who have built wonderful businesses, bakeries, garment selling. There are huge businesses which have been built and they are just building purely on Facebook and WhatsApp because WhatsApp integration is allowed with Facebook.
Yes.
So you can create a Facebook business account, integrate it with the WhatsApp account and it works like a charm. So I think it's all, as we said, what works for you is what you have to identify and then use it. That's it. Tools are available for everyone. You want to get into, right?
Okay, thank you.
So would you want to take a break, Dr. Shivkiran, now? Because we have just been 1 hour.
That's better. We'll take 10 minutes. We'll take quick and we'll be back just exactly 10 minutes.
Yeah.
What is the timeline you are having?
Sure. Yeah. So when we come back, I'll focus more on the tools for businesses specifically. We've already covered a lot of tools for individual entrepreneur side. So we'll focus on the business side of it now.
For sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Thank you.
We'll start, sir. We'll resume.
Can we start?
Yes, yes.
Okay, great. So everyone had their coffee. Okay, let me, any questions after that, after the first session? We had some interesting discussion towards the end. Any other thoughts anyone has? If nothing, then we can start on with the next part. Okay. Let me just go to okay. So when we come to tools for business, see again we are talking about how do we choose. First of all, it's important how do we choose the tool. So like the question came, where do you really need the tool? Is it going to be relevant for you? So once you've decided that you need a tool, then you need to decide for what purpose do you need the tool? What is it that you're going to do? So there's a simple way which you can think of. What is it that you as a business owner is going to do for that business? So let's say if you are into business of, let's say, designing something. So are you the key designer who will be doing it? So you need a tool for designing. If you are into business, you're an architect or you are into something which you are creating, let's say you're a coder, then you need the relevant tools for doing that. So first thing is to decide what is it that you as a business owner or a founder is going to do on your own. What is it that your tool will, a team will do? So you need a tool for your team. What is it that you're going to subcontract? So while the key project remains with you, part of it is being done by someone else. And what is it that you're completely outsourcing? So when it comes to outsourcing, you don't really need to worry about what tools are being used as long as the person who's doing that part for you is taking care of it. The critical part to focus is what is it that you will do on your own and what is the team going to do? These are the two things where you need tools, right? So there are three areas where maximum tools are used by startups and even micro startups, if you want to call them. And I am focusing on these three, but I'll also cover tools in other areas. So primarily, I want to talk about these. So the first part is in terms of productivity, not only your own, but your team. So if your team is working, how does it work with others, especially in current scenario where people are working from different locations and even remotely, how is it that they manage to collaborate and work with each other? How do you create your web presence? Because no business today can remain, you know, unconnected digitally. We are talking about some kind of web presence. So whether it's a kind of listing presence on social media or any kind of advertising marketing you want to do, even as simple as putting up a Google ad or something like that. So we're talking about that. And the third part we are focusing on is some tool, some kind of methodology to acquire customers and manage their data and to analyze that data. Now, even if we look at something like we were talking about a vegetable lender. There are farmers nowadays who are using tools to check the crop prices, you know, the prices in different markets. They are using apps to check the amount of fertilizer to be put based on the soil condition. They're using the seed quality measurement. They're checking the humidity conditions and all that. So every scenario or phase, there are some kind of tools which have come up, which can be used. What I'm talking about here is, so you may feel that I'm not covering something which is related to a particular area. So what I'm trying to showcase or generalize here is the key functions where you may need tools across businesses. And then there will be some specific tools which will be relevant only for that business. So that can be customized, or they can choose what they want to do. So let me come to just try and list out a couple of products. you will find a lot of these products may not be Indian. Some of them are Indian, but I've chosen the products which are good and free, and it doesn't matter which kind of origin they have or which country they belong to, basically. So the product suites, I think this is something which almost everyone uses. In fact, beyond these product suites, there are open the open source codes also available. A very common one is called Open Document, which you can use freely. But the advantage of using one of these suites is that they give you a lot of advantage. And Google, in fact, Google is one product which is majority of things which you need for a small business is free. What do you need? You need an email. You can use a Gmail and you can add all kinds of email, because people don't mind a Gmail nowadays. Unless you want a domain name, then you'll have to buy one. But you can use Google. You can use Google Docs. Excel sheets are available, the spreadsheets. You can create PowerPoints on Google. You have whiteboards on Google, which you can use for product presentation if you want to talk to a client. You have the Google Meet, which is again a free platform. And starting, I think, 30th September onwards, it will still be free for 1 hour call. So basically, almost everything you want for a small business is available free on Google. Unless you, if you want to really expand, you want to go into a branded suite, then you need to buy a Google Suite package or pay for it. But otherwise, everything is available free. Microsoft is more versatile, but obviously you have to pay for it. So even the basic version of a lot of people use, I know the pirated software versions, but if you want to really go for a licensed version, it is expensive. And Microsoft now has a kind of a pay as you use thing, so where you can use the complete Office suite as software as a service. You can purchase it on rent kind of thing instead of buying a license. Zoho is an Indian company which has a wonderful platform, but everything is paid. So that's something which you need to be clear about. The meeting tool, I think, is available free. I'm not sure, but almost everything on Zoho, but it's priced reasonably. So if there is someone who wants to go for it, they can use it. I have used Google right from day one since I decided to start my business. And there was a wonderful product earlier called Google Talk, which was such an amazing tool for even sending files or discussing something. They discontinued and brought in Hangout, and I think now they are discontinuing Hangout also, and merging it with Google Meet or something like Google Chat, whatever. But Google has one of the best tools, and I would recommend any business who want to start with this if you don't want to really pay for it. Then there are tools for meeting. So Zoom is free up to 40 minutes, which serves good. Ideally, meetings should not last more than 30 minutes. But if you want to do it, you can always do repeat meetings on Zoom. So it's a very versatile and very, very light platform. So Zoom requires very less bandwidth. It's a very good tool. And some of the features which are available on Zoom are really good. It allows you to annotate. It allows you to do focus discussions and all. Meet is also good. Teams obviously comes as part of Microsoft Teams, Microsoft Office Suite, the complete one, Enterprise Suite. So it's expensive and you have to buy it. So I would want to go with a Meet or a Zoom if it is free. And especially clients are very comfortable doing on Meet because they think it's a safer product. But Zoom is also widely accepted. So you can suggest that. We are doing this meeting in Zoom, and it's much less bandwidth as compared to the Zoho one, which we did last time. Okay, there are some collaboration tools like Miro, Mural, Padlet, and Slack. Now, what are collaboration tools used for? So they may not be relevant for teams if they are at the same place, but they become relevant, especially now many businesses are hiring people who are willing to work from home. So there is a change in scenario. What people were earlier looking for offices, there are many companies which are comfortable now with right away people joining from home. So I can give you examples of even larger organizations. Smaller ones are doing it, but larger organizations like banks are comfortable with people joining online. So the whole orientation program, the induction, joining, everything is being done online, right? Documentation. So when you have teams spread out across multiple locations, you need some kind of tools where whatever they do can also be seen by others. And at the same time, you can sync it. So my first choice even for collaboration is a Google Suite, because you can create a Google Sheet or a Word document or a PPT and everyone can work on it. And the person who creates it can create, can, you know, put so many restrictions or permissions in it. So I'm sure you would all be aware. So if you're not aware, if you want me to have a quick go through of Google, let me know. But otherwise, I'm assuming that everyone uses all Google products, so we are aware. But Google Sheets allow you to protect data. If you're creating, let's say, an Excel sheet with a business plan and two people are working on it, you can protect some part of data, and you can create forms. So you can actually conduct, between two teams, if you want to create some kind of survey, you want to have exchanging notes, it allows you to save data on Google Drive. So you can save your files, images, videos, whatever you want. So it's one of the best. I personally feel it's a boon or a blessing for all the entrepreneurs. Okay. If you really want...
You said you will say something about Google, how to use it. Is it possible to show it, sir?
I can quickly showcase it. Let me just finish this slide and then I'll quickly show you a couple of things on Google, one or two docs, how you can use it and create it. Yeah. Okay. So there are some tools which you can use for project management. Like Asana is a very widely used tool. Again, all these tools are free for the basic version, but if you need them. So my advice to every business I talk to is don't use a tool if you don't need it. As simple as that. Find first whether you really need something. If not, if you can pick up a phone and get a work done, do that way. Avoid all tools. But some of them have become necessary. So for example, storage. If you want data to be available at any place. So Google Drive is one thing, but you can also use free version of Dropbox. I think it allows up to 20 GB data. You can access it from any laptop, any phone, any computer, anywhere. If you want to scale up, you have the cloud platforms or AWS, Amazon, and Microsoft as an Azure platform, which you can use for storage. There are some HR tools. In fact, there are a huge number of HR softwares which are available. And you can just do a simple Google search and you'll find a list of some 100 names. Some of them which work really well. Zoho has its own platform. You can take it based on the number of people you have. Now, why you should take a platform for doing HR functions once you have crossed at least 3-4 people is because there are a lot of compliances related to HR. And I have seen people struggling with compliances. They don't pay attention to it. They keep looking at growing their business. But this is one area you can get caught. And this is one area which will become a headache for you at a later date. So taking care of professional tax or, ESIC, gratuity, these things become relevant. PT and, PF and gratuity become relevant only after you have crossed 20 employees. But for a taxation purpose, if you're maintaining salaries, if you're maintaining employee records, these are all relevant from a labor law perspective. You need to have a proper record of attendance. While you can have a physical register, but it requires you to maintain some kind of tool where you can calculate salaries, where you can issue pay slips. See, you, even though everything can be done on a simple Word or a Google document, but it is tedious. When you go for a simple tool, it helps you make the process more efficient. But you should tell your people or entrepreneurs only to start using these tools when they really feel a need, but always keep an eye on it, that they need it. Okay. So the second set of tools I'm going to talk about are primarily related to the presence on the web. And out of this, I'll show you one or two. Wix, you're already, I think WordPress someone has talked about, they're already aware. Just to tell you, WordPress has two kinds of platforms. So one is the blog platform, which is wordpress.com. They also have something called wordpress.org, where you can create a full-fledged websites for free. The only issue is that it appears under a domain name of WordPress. If you want your own domain to appear there, you have to pay for it. Some $30 a year or something they charge for it. But WordPress is a wonderfully easy platform to create a website. You can create a free website on it. Wix is another platform where you can create an absolutely free website. It gives you all kinds of add-ons. You can have an e-commerce site. You can have a payment gateway mechanism right inside the site. You can create a blog, you can create a gallery, showcase, whatever. It's all free, but it charges you for add-ins. So if you want to add a survey tool, it will charge you something. If you want their name to disappear, it will charge you something. But otherwise, all these are free available. On designing...
Sir, please, please compare with the Google Sites also, which is better one at least.
Google Sites is okay for a basic website. If you want to really go for something like if you want to have a let's say a payment gateway available within the site, you want to also have a blog, a gallery, you want to showcase your products, and you want to be able to sell right through the website. Google Sites is pretty basic in that sense. And if you want to go for advanced features, you have to pay for them. Wix allows you a lot many free features. That's why I've chosen that. I've not listed Google here. While I've talked about Google at a lot of other places, this particular place, I will not talk about Google because it's not such a great site in terms of building a website. But yes, if you want a simple website, just to have a presence, then it's fine to go with a Google site also. So Google has something called a marketplace, you know, so you can just add it to your maps. I'm sure you would be aware in Google Maps app, there is an option called marketplace where you can create, Google Places. So where you can create a listing for your place and it appears on the map for everyone in that locality. So that's a very nice feature for someone to locate you. So if anyone wants to talk about it, but for a website, I would not necessarily recommend Google Sites. Okay. Okay. So there are a couple of sites for designing. So where does designing come in? So when you want to create a logo for your business, you want to create a simple banner for yourself, you want to create a design of a, let's say, a letterhead, or you want to create a HTML document, which you want to send as an email. So there is a site called Canva. Canva is a global leader in terms of designing sites. 99design is another one, but Canva gives you ability to create designs for any platform. So you can create a banner for YouTube, you can create a video for YouTube, you can create a Facebook banner, you can do something for WhatsApp, you can create a simple handout or a poster and you can print it. Canva is one place which I think anyone can use intuitively.
Sir, excuse me.
Yeah.
Sir, is it a video editing tool, sir? Can
we No. I'll show you Canva. I'll try to show you. Okay. So Canva is a tool which can be used for creating. And you can also edit it. I'll show you Canva and you will realize what all can you do through it.
Okay. Just,
I think someone had put something on chat. Just give me a moment. So let me finish this slide, then I'll take what is there on chat and come to it. So I'll show you Canva. I'll also try to show you Hootsuite. Hootsuite is a tool for social media management. So if you have a business owner who wants to monitor their presence on 4 or 5 platforms, so let's say Facebook, YouTube, Instagram also, and they are also present on LinkedIn. So everything can be seen at one place. This again is free of charge. Hootsuite can also be used for planning and scheduling your posts. So if you are in a business where you want to keep putting out things, you know, a lot of businesses are now using WhatsApp status message as a tool for showcasing their product. So they keep them as every day they keep adding their product listing and all the people who are in contact can see. Hootsuite can help you do the same thing on all social media. So you can create one post and it could go to all the places in a single click of a button. If you want to conduct surveys in local market, you can use SurveyMonkey, again, a free tool. Google Forms is also very good for it. In fact, Google Forms is also being used now by a lot of teachers for creating assessments. It is being used by a lot of companies for registration purpose. So even for Zoom meetings, there are small businesses, trainers, there are people who are running, vendors. I've seen vendors, dry fruit vendors. In fact, one of my contacts sells dry fruits through WhatsApp and he has a link for Google Form wherein you can update what you want to buy and it calculates the total amount which you have to pay automatically and you can just pay through a Paytm or a Google Pay or things like that. So people are using these tools in a very nice way. Yeah.
And it's a very effective assessment tool also, sir.
Effective because Google Forms allows you to automatically calculate the score also. You can put the answers and you can actually do an auto evaluation as well. So it's a wonderful tool which can be used. And entrepreneurs can use it for survey as well because you can create, when you're conducting a survey, there are a lot of situations where you want a different question to be asked based on an answer. So it allows you to ask conditional questions. So if the answer is yes, it will take you to a different question. If the answer is no, it will take you to a different question. So all those possibilities are there in Google Forms. It's pretty nice. Google Analytics is again a free of charge tool. You can just insert it in your website and it will take care of all the analytics of who visited, which pages were visited, which country people came from, what device they used. Everything appears. If you want to use, if you are using Google Ads, that data also appears in Google Analytics. So that can be taken care of. Listings, I already talked about BizCircle. JustDial is another tool. It has a free version, which is not very effective. Normally, they will keep calling you to pay so that your listing comes up higher. So unless someone really needs it. But what is good about JustDial now is that they have included things like scheduling an appointment or paying directly through JustDial, which works well, especially for small businesses where you want consultants. If you have consultants there, if you have people who where you want to take some kind of advance or you want to talk to someone before you actually go and buy, JustDial works really well. Okay, let me show you some CRM tools. So CRM is basically, what are we talking about CRM? When you start building customers and you want to send out something to them regularly, and you also want to keep checking data as to what are the leads generated, how many are getting converted. So if you feel that that kind of data is important for you, what is the customer who is buying from you? What are their gender, age group? If you are in a business which this is relevant, then you need a CRM tool. If not, then you don't need to get into it, because these are all tools which help you reach out to customers in an automated way. Some kind of automated mail, data to analyze people, running campaigns online, all those kind of things. So if you don't think you need that, you can avoid all this. Okay. Digital signing. Okay. This has become relevant now, because a lot of businesses, now we are not going into physical signing of documents. Many businesses are insisting that we sign an agreement online. So there are products like Zoho has a very nice product, in fact, but the two leaders in the market are DocuSign and Adobe. But Zoho Sign also is very good. So you can actually talk about that as well. Legal and compliance, where you need forms. So there are many sites. There is one very good site called Vakil. But most of the Indian sites have templates which help you get. Lawyered is one site which I found very good in India. They have a very nice list of all kinds of documents which a small business needs, and it works really well. But many of these legal and compliance documents you will find on sites of companies which are into formation of businesses. So all these management consultants who help you in forming companies and all will also have this kind of some basic template of documents. You can also use many other sites where you get PDF documents. For example, SlideShare is one place where I've saw people uploading a lot of agreements and document formats, but you need to really check if they are valid legally or not. So these two sites which I mentioned, Evodocs and Lawyered, they are actually legal sites which have proper documents in various formats. And many of them are free to download the basic documents. Okay, accounts and finance. My belief is that every entrepreneur should know financial accounting, at least the basics. Where it becomes useful is when you run a business, you may lose sight of the costs and you may lose sight of the compliance part, and which can come back to hit you pretty badly. So it's, you can take a simple tally. Tally is a very, very, it's a wonderful tool, and it's an Indian tool which is available. You can buy a rental subscription of Tally for as less as, I think 600 rupees a month kind of thing. But for a business who wants to maintain their book right from day one, see, where will this become relevant? So some of us may feel that a small business may not need this. So let's say you are creating a wonderful business which is prospect of getting highly valued. But someone comes for valuing your business, they are going to ask you for your account statements, for your books. That is when a lot of businesses feel that they have not maintained, and that's where they get hit. You will not believe, venture capitalists look at so many businesses and reject many of them simply because they did not have the discipline of maintaining proper books. They have not paid their local taxes on time. They don't maintain the TDS records. They have not maintained the salary records. So it's my personal recommendation that you should tell every business owner to invest in a Tally, at least Tally basic, or go for a Zoho account or something basic, which can keep things in an ordered way. They can always move to a bigger ERP or whatever in future if they feel the business is growing too fast. But to begin with, they should start and they should learn to operate it on their own. And all these tools are very intuitive. I have no background in accounting. I am a finance person. I have not done an accounting, but I could learn Tally within 10 days. As simple as that. Very simple to use. For IT professionals, especially those who are into development side, there are two resources which they can think of. GitHub is one where you can put all your codes and you can get professionals to work on your codes as well. Same is Rent-A-Coder. So Rent-A-Coder is a site for coding professionals. So if you want something to be done, as simple as, let's say you want a website to be developed, you can put out a project there. People will code for it. You can choose someone, do it for you, pay it online. They will finish the project and deliver it to you. So it's like a marketplace for IT professionals, especially software developers. You can use it. There is also a site, I think in India, Fiverr or something, which is trying to work on a similar thing, but especially they work on CRM and presence side. But I think they're also adding coders, Indian coders, but Rent-A-Coder has a lot of Indian coders there online. So you can use their services if you wish to. Okay. Before I showcase those tools to you, I want to finish the presentation part and tell you a couple of things so that this is something which we should keep in mind. So tools are not a substitute for the work you do. They are only enablers. So many entrepreneurs use multiple tools feeling that now that they have a tool, things will happen. If you don't use the tool, it's not going to happen. So having a tool and using it are two different things, right? Second is tools are only as good as the user. So what is the best thing you are going to do with a tool depends on you. There are a lot of capabilities in a particular tool available, but if you're not really using them, that doesn't make too much sense. It's always better to go for a tool which you can understand. So don't go for a tool because someone is telling, because I am telling, or because they are appearing as number one. So if you feel a particular tool, simple tool works for you well, for your requirement, go for it. Because it makes more sense that you spend less time in learning a tool and more time you spend in using it, right? Tools that can integrate with each other would be better. But for that, you will have to normally go for tools which are slightly pricey. But if they can talk to each other, it's better, because in future, as a business grows, you may need the same data at multiple places. So for example, if you're using an Excel sheet for maintaining customer data today, tomorrow, you should have a CRM tool which has capability to upload that Excel data. Otherwise, you'll have to create the whole data again. If you're using your phone to maintain your contact list and to, you know, WhatsApp to broadcast, so ideally, you should in future move to a tool which allows you to import that data so that all that hard work which you have done in terms of creating the lists, segmenting customers can be done. So look, always tell your students to use tools or entrepreneurs to use tools which can talk to each other, which can integrate. Tools have to work across platforms. There is no, should absolutely avoid tools which work only on a particular platform or a space, even if they are the best. Because if you cannot change, people nowadays are changing phones and laptops and systems are developing so fast that if you don't have a tool which works across platforms, it'll be difficult to keep up. And lastly, use as less tools as you can. I have used only Excel for a long time, even in initial years, even though now I'm talking about Tally from day one. I used to use an Excel sheet for maintaining my accounts. And that's when I realized that what I'm doing is not right. But use minimum tools as you can. Don't get into tools if you don't need it. Again and again, I'm saying that, right? Any questions before I move on to showcasing a couple of these tools? So I'll show you Google Drive, I'll show you Canva, and I'll also try to show you Hootsuite. If you want to talk about anything before I move into that, just let me know. Meanwhile, I try and open those sites. So let me first. Any questions or anyone who wants to say anything?
These free tools that you're saying, sir, how long will it support the business? After some time, when they see you use it very often, then they'll start charging you?
No. So it's not dependent on usage, ma'am. What happens is, see, most of the tools have some basic functionality which are free. If you want to use more things from that same tool, then they ask you to pay. That's it. So it's not dependent on usage, but it's dependent on what features you are using from the tool. That's how it works.
Okay.
So it's free. Otherwise, for example, Zoom, if you see 40-minute call at a time is free.
Mm-hmm.
But Zoom doesn't say how many calls can you make. You can make as many 40-minute call in a month as you want. It doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
But the moment you want to go beyond 40 minutes, so either you make multiple calls or you pay for unlimited time that way. So it doesn't matter. So I'll give you, for example, there is one tool called StreamYard. StreamYard is a tool which is used for broadcasting. So if someone is on doing live video sessions, it is a tool. So they have a restriction of 20 hours per month. In 20 hours, you can do in a single day, or you can do one hour for 20 days. So they put those restrictions. Within that, it is free.
Mm-hmm.
So let me just show you a couple of tools. So any other questions, you can feel free to keep asking while I'm setting this up.
What did you say? StreamYard, is it? Stream?
Yeah, StreamYard. StreamYard.
And what can you do in that? You can give ad in that? Or?
StreamYard is a... No. It's a tool for broadcasting. So, for example, if you're doing a live video, say, as a business owner, suppose you want to reach out to customers and you're doing a live session on showcasing your product. You want to launch a product. So you can use StreamYard to simultaneously broadcast yourself on YouTube, Facebook pages, multiple groups, LinkedIn, everywhere with a single tool. It can go to all the places and people can watch you there. And whatever comments they put, you can reply from StreamYard itself. From any platform they are putting comments or liking or sharing something, you can do that. So you can even invite guests. So for example, if you are in an industry where you want a guest to come and talk about your business, you can invite them on that show. You can do it. So that kind of possible.
So that more of 20 hours can be used anywhere. In a day, I can use 3 hours, 2 hours.
Yeah. In a month, they allow 20 hours.
Okay,
one second. Let me just... There's some network problem I'm facing today here. That's why the system is a bit slow. Okay, you're able to see my screen, right? Moment.
Yeah.
Let me show you. So let me first show you Hootsuite. Okay, so this is a tool I was talking about which can help you in social media management. So see, I have actually set up three various tools in that. So I can use this tool directly to broadcast to my page on LinkedIn, on Facebook and Twitter. All I need to do is, so there is an option here on the left side. If you see, I'm just going to create. So it helps me create a post. And it helps me choose where I want to send this post to, which kind of platforms I need to send. All I need to do is choose there, create the post. I can send it now or I can schedule it. So if you have something, let's say a series of 5 articles you want to post or 5 product messages you want to talk about over a week, you can just do the scheduling here and leave it. It'll automatically post on all the sites for you. So this is a free account which allows you integration up to 3. So see here, you can choose where you want to post. But if I want to post on all 3 or only one of them, I can just select and accordingly go for it. So this is a very simple tool to use. So I can create a text here, and schedule it for later. So it gives me an option to either schedule, and it also shows me how it is going to appear on my particular page. The good thing about this is that, let me just show you this. It shows me all the posts, what kind of likes and what kind of comments I have. So I can directly access the comments and like from here without going to my Facebook page, without going to my LinkedIn profile. So whatever is appearing there, it just gives me the complete data here. And this is free. But if I want some information related to analytics as to which site, how many people are visiting, then I need to pay for it. Otherwise, it's completely free of charge, up to 3 accounts. So this is a tool which can be very useful for people, and it saves a lot of time for me in terms of posting. Okay, let me show you the other tool which I was talking about. Okay, this is Canva. Now, Canva helps you design anything. So let me just show you what all can you design. So there is an option on the top here. You can see create a design. It will show you a list of what you can do. So you can create a video. You can create a YouTube thumbnail. You can create a flyer, logo, announcement, poster, Facebook post. You can create a presentation, an invitation, anything. And this tool is free, absolutely free. You can create a letterhead, ID cards if you want to create for your employees. You know, everything can be created free. And once you have created, you can just download it. You can download it. And so I'll show you one of the formats which I had created. Let me just show if I have something here. So this is a brochure which I had created for one of the meets which we conduct. Now this allows you, if I just show you, so it has, you can insert videos, you can insert music. So if you want to create a video, you can even create music. And it allows you to download here. So all the formats, you see, it can download as a PDF. You can download it as an image. Any kind of, you can even download it as a PPT or as a video. So all the formats. It's a very good tool, very versatile. And
yeah. The videos created in this Canva, and where they all will be stored, sir?
And you can download it.
Second one is, can we share the videos to other platforms?
Yeah. So if you are not downloading, the videos will remain on this platform. So this is like a website, and you can access it from anywhere, any tool. If you're downloading it, it will download as a MP4 file, which is a normal video format file, which you can share with anyone on any platform, even through WhatsApp. You can upload that video anywhere. So this is a MP4 format video, which gets created. But I even wonderful.
Here, sir.
Yeah.
Be it this Canva or Design Hill or Canva, any of those things. Suppose you are creating some, you know, icon or anything.
Yeah.
It will also select some icons, its own creation, or it would have got licensed or something.
Yeah.
Is it having any infringement things associated with this? Any of those?
There are some stock tools which are available, which are free of license, which they mention. And there are some ones which you can buy. So you can pay and buy something them, like which, so that you become like the owner of license.
Something like this.
But here it's much.
Okay.
Yeah. So the difference here is that there are a lot of free things you normally don't need to buy.
Correct.
Most of the templates, images they have created, they are free. Only some of them. So if you, let's say you are using any music, you know, they'll be mostly royalty free music or image. But if you want to use something which is having some kind of a license, then you can pay the, I think everything is priced at $1. So as simple as that, you don't have to pay anything more than that. If you want everything free, then you can try a pro account, which gives you a lot of other facilities.
Correct. Yeah.
This is one tool which is really good and works very nicely. Okay, let me
about editing. During editing, can we have the feature of a green screen and chroma key I'm talking about?
You can create a green screen on this.
Chroma key. Oh yes. Oh, wonderful, sir.
Sorry?
This is a wonderful tool. Thank you.
You can create everything in this. You can create a green screen also. In fact, you can even, when you're creating a presentation, let's say I'm showing this, you can even share it with another member of your team who can edit it. So let's say you are creating as a, even in your college, for example, you create something and you want another faculty member to edit it. You can share a link with them and they can edit it also while it remains here. So, you know, that's again free. You don't need to really pay for it. Let me show you Google Drive Docs first and then I will. So see, Google Docs, I'm sure some of or other way you would have used it, but I'll just show you one or two, and most of the features are very common. So Google Drive is the primary source of documents, all kinds of documents where you save. It allows you two kinds of things. You can create folders, or you can even upload a file which you have on your laptop. Once you upload it, it becomes accessible everywhere. So let me show you a Google Sheet. So basically what you can create on Google Drive is a document, which is like a Word document. Sheet is like an Excel sheet. Slides is a PowerPoint. And you have Google Forms, which is what we were talking about, assessment tools. You also have your Maps, Google Sites. Jamboard is a whiteboard kind of thing, which can be used online. Right? So let me show you Sheets, which is something which can be very useful. So let me just create quickly and show you what is possible. So this is like a simple Excel sheet. The only difference here is that anyone can access it once you provide a link. Right. So let me give a link, create and give a link to you. Maybe you can just try using it if you have even if you don't have a Google account. I'll just name it Test Sheet. Let me share a link with you all, which you can use to edit. So there is a share option wherein it gives me two kinds of permissions. So either you can share it with someone whose email ID I have. So that gives us selective access, or I can even share it with anyone who has a link of this sheet. So let me just change it to anyone with link. And I'll make it to editor so that you can all edit it. Copy link. Okay, let me just put this in chat. So I've just given the link in chat. You can just click on this link and it will bring you to this sheet. Now, what I wanted to show you is if you have some data which you don't want anyone to modify, you can create something like protected sheet. So let me just write something here. Okay, and I don't want anyone to change this. What I can do is go to data, and there is something called protect sheets and ranges. So I just go to protect, and I set permission in such a way that no one else can change it. So I just select this. And I say restrict only to me. So now when you come to this sheet, you will not be able to edit these three places. Same way you can actually create multiple sheets. You can create, so people who want to, you know, create lists, or you're working on a project, you have a business plan where you want to show to, let's say, someone who wants to fund it. You can create a sheet and share it with them where they can only comment. So you can change the permissions in such a way that people cannot change, but they can comment on it and ask questions. And once someone asks questions, it can be replied to. So you can use this in a nice way. There are a lot of add-ons they have in terms of graphs and charts. You can use, you can create as many sheets as you want. Google Drive has a limit of, I think, about 17 GB, which gives you free. So you can use as many sheets as you want because the data doesn't take too much of place. So you can, if you want, you can access it and just try it out. But more importantly, two things which I really like about Sheets is, one, the shareability; two, the ability to protect what you want to protect; and three, there is no cost involved. So you can create multiple sheets, you can link them, you can use it for importing data, exporting data. It is compatible with Excel. So at any point of time, if you feel that you now need it in Excel format, all you need to do is to go to File and say download as Excel. You can download as Microsoft Excel. You can download as open document format, a PDF. You can even create something called, access permission so that people, when they download it, it'll appear as a PDF kind of thing. So all those features are there. Okay, let me just quickly move on to this. One more thing I want to show. Okay. Okay. So I've showed you Hootsuite. I'll just show you SurveyMonkey if that's something which is relevant you find, because I think that might be useful to some of the people. While I showed forms. And all these, you don't even need to create an account. You can just directly log in, mostly using your Google credentials, because Google allows you sign in almost on the platform. So even people who are creating an account, you don't need to really create a new login and password. SurveyMonkey is useful for people who want to conduct market surveys, who want to create, so you can create, I think up to 5 surveys at any point of time are allowed free of charge. Each survey can have up to 10 questions. So it allows you to send the survey online. You can even get a link and send it through WhatsApp. There are many kind of places where I get from students who have created on SurveyMonkey. So you can just type question and add, or you also have templates. So for example, I want to create a So you have templates here where you can start from scratch. You can create a, test and add a product. It gives you what kind of responses are, what are popular things. So for example, here you see the kind of surveys which have already been created. Customer satisfaction template is there. You have a market research product testing template. Even for colleges, there is a website feedback template where people can give you feedback. So a lot of feedback, are there templates are there which you can use, or you can create on your own also. So this is also a free tool available, as long as you don't need to use it too frequently or too many of features you want to use. Any other tool you would specifically want to see, I can showcase it to you, because I've listed a lot of them. Let me just start the presentation and so that you can have a look at it. If there is something you want to understand, I can show that to you specifically.
Designing tools.
There's so many of them. That... Yeah, so Canva is the one which I showed you.
That is what?
Canva is a designing tool. Canva is for designing. You just saw
and,
Canva?
For
that is
a designing tool. For bookmaking, bookmaking.
If you're writing a book, is that what you're asking? Bookmaking
means?
Yes.
Yeah.
So there are, bookmaking, writing, there are a lot of tools. So there is one tool called Scrivener. Scrivener is a paid software, but it's a wonderful tool. If you are a serious writer, you can use that.
All paid. I want free ones.
Yeah. So I think book writing, I'm not aware, because I have personally not used. I use Scrivener free, the paid version. But otherwise, if you are into really taking notes and writing, you can actually use Evernote. Because Evernote allows you to write and link your ideas. So you can use Evernote. Okay, I can show you something which might be useful for you. Let me just see if I can bring it. Google Docs allows you a lot of features for writers, because it can do automatic indexing. It allows you to create links between pages and all those kind of things. Let me just start it. I'll show a document which I have created. This is a product proposal which I'm talking about. So you can see what I have done there. It'll give you a sense of what all can be done. Just give me a moment.
So one more thing I want to ask. You said you can make a free website with that WordPress and Wix and all. How long can it be free, sir? Like, how long can you show it on the website?
It's free forever. But see, Wix, when you make a free website, on the website, a tag appears in the top saying made on Wix. So if you don't want that, then they ask you to pay. But otherwise, the website will be free. You can see what happens is basically you buy a domain name from one of the domain providers. So first you need to buy a .com or a .in or a .org kind of a domain name, which is definitely you have to buy. Once you've bought it, you can just direct from there to Wix or to WordPress and it'll appear there. So it's free of charge. They won't charge you based on how long you're for a product proposal. Now, the moment you create these headings, so I'm showing you this broad concept. So the moment I put it as a heading, it appears on the left side as an index. So this is a very useful thing. So when you are creating a long note or a, let's say, a thesis kind of thing or a paper you're writing, you can create this. So if I click on something, let's say challenges, so it will straight away take me to that particular section. This is one good thing. The other thing is you have, let me just show that to you. They have a feature called research. So if you go to tools, there's something called explore. Sorry. So if you say explore on the right hand side, this window appears. Now, if I want to explore something on the topic on which I am writing, so let's say you're writing on vegetable. Okay. So it will give you all the Google search options on vegetables related thing. So you can just directly pick. If you have an image you want to pick from here, which is royalty free, you can pick. If there is a content on web which you want to access, it gives you access to that. So this is something very wonderful, especially for academicians who are writing or preparing or for a subject. You can do all this. So
okay.
This is a very nice option. You can also create images and content. It works pretty nice and it allows you to format in various ways. And again, this is shareable. So you can share it with a colleague. If you want someone to only read it and not make changes, there are three options there. So you can give a suggesting option wherein they can read it and they can give comments, but they won't be able to change any content. Or you can give just the viewing rights to them. So they can only view or they can edit it. So all the, these modes are available. So this is something very simple and it works. This is again free completely.
Sir, sorry to disturb you.
Yeah.
Sir, the videos created under Canva, will they get the watermark or without watermark?
No. There is no watermark.
Wow. So free. Wonderful, sir. Thank you.
Completely
thank you so
free.
Much. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, as you have said about the Google Sheet,
yes,
which can be used to collect the data from different members, sir.
Right.
And specifically, if you don't want to give permission for editing, as you said,
yeah,
like you know, we cannot give the permission.
Yes.
But, my question is that, sir. See, for example, I want to collect data from 10 members of faculty, sir.
Right.
And I will create like you know, I require data from like you know, for every against every faculty.
Hmm.
But what is happening, you know, editing is to be done because they have to enter their data. But
instead,
they may even have a chance to edit by others also. My point is that, do we have a mechanism? We can give permission only that, like, you know, row only for those faculties, respective faculty.
So, see, how you can do it is you can create something called a dashboard where the data from different faculty can come at one place, but the entry point you can give. So let me just share and show it to you what possibly can be done.
Yes.
So you are saying basically you want different faculty to enter data for the same maybe parameters. Everyone has to enter the data, but
yes,
each person should be able to enter only their data and others should not be able to edit it. Correct?
Yes, sir,
that's
yes,
what it is.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so the way I protected this sheet, let me just show.
Uh, others data must be
reopened
under is must be only read only for others.
Yeah. So let me just show the same sheet to you again. So in this, I protected this data by saying that it should be visible. It should be editable only to me. Okay.
Yes,
but
yes.
If I go to again that same option of data, it gives me an option to in protect sheet range only. It gives me an option to choose a particular user who can edit this.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, sir.
So I can make those particular rows or cells only editable by one particular person. Similarly, each cell can be assigned to only specific people and you can put their names on the top. So only that person will be able to fill those cells. Okay. Others will not be able to fill them and they cannot change them also.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay. Any other queries or questions if we have, or if you want to ask any particular thing, then I can probably give answers.
Sir, in the previous thing, entire row, no, sir? Entire row can be protected and can
you can protect one sheet, one cell, a number of rows, whole column, everything is possible. So you just need to define which rows to protect, which cells to protect.
Yeah, but that specific row, okay, we can give the permission.
You can, yes.
Exclusive one user only.
Yeah, you can do that.
Thank you.
Yeah. So if any other questions are there, I would be happy to answer them. Otherwise, from my side, we are more or less done because there is no end to the kind of tools we can talk about. Even I have not covered all the tools which were mentioned in the PPT, but there are so many that you know, the tools, as you use them and when you have a need arises, that's when you try using them, and most of them are pretty easy to learn. So
sir, there's a website creation tool you have told, sir. Website, how to create the website tool.
So Wix is one where you can use. I can show you Wix quickly.
Sir, Adab, and I also want to know, you said without creating a Google account, you can use all this. What is the difference between creating a Google account and not creating a Google account? Any advantages in that?
No. What I was saying was that Google, if you have a Google account, you don't need to create account on most of these applications or tools. You can just use your Google account directly to log into all of these, because Google, they all are, you know, connected with Google in some way or other. So it allows, if you have a Google account, it gives you access to almost all sites using the same credentials. But a lot of other sites, like for example, if you have a Facebook or a LinkedIn account, they also allow you access to most of the sites to that. But Google is the, what do you say, available across maximum sites. So if you have a Google account, it helps.
I have secondly, Google account, sir, but I forgot the password. I'm not able to open it after that.
Oh, then I think you will have to go and either reset it or probably create a new account kind of thing. So if you see, even through Wix, I'm logged in on my Google account only. I'm using my Gmail to log in here. You can see. Mm-hmm. So this is Wix. It is very simple. It, all you need to do is, it says create a new site. You can go. It gives you a lot of templates and options for creating what you want to do. You can choose the kind of industry you are in. The segment, you can put the data. Let me just show you. So see, it asks you what kind of website you want. So let's say I go for an online store, for example. So it says create your website with Creator, or you can directly create it. It's an automated process. So let me choose an automated process. Say start now. It'll ask a couple of questions. And then it'll create a design for me automatically. You don't need to really know anything about web designing or any tool. Mm-hmm. It just does it on its own. So it says what type of So if you have a, let's say I'm just choosing something as of now. So online home goods store. Okay. So it says what features are recommended for you. So do you want to have a chat feature, bookings? Do you want a blog? So you can choose whatever features you want. So I am just saying chat at the moment and bookings, let's say. Say next. What is the name of your store? So let me just put it as. It asks you a couple of questions. If there is an existing website, you can import. If you have a Google Places, you can import all that data here. If there's nothing, you can just go to next. So it gives all these details. You review this, go to next. It'll give you a design. What you want to choose. So let me say luxury. Okay. Net is terribly slow today, so bear with me for this. Let me just switch off my video, that might help make it faster.
In fact, most of our startups are using Wix.
Yeah. Wix is a very commonly used and one of the top rated sites. Only thing is Wix becomes expensive the moment you scale up. Scaling up is difficult on Wix. So that is a challenge. So that's why a lot of people shift to.
So what do you mean?
Yeah. But the moment you want to upgrade, no? See, when you want to go for a lot of features, so if you don't want the Wix name to appear, if you want to add, let's say, so for me, when I wanted to add a job posting site, they charged for it. You know, if you want to add a e-commerce payment option, they will charge for you. So these things, when you want to scale, if you want a basic website with all the things, then it will be fine. But the moment you want to go for something which is additional, then you have to pay for things. So let's say I'm just saying use this design. It's very simple. Actually, you don't really need any tutorial to use Wix.
Yeah, this is like exploratory. Make and break sort of thing. You can do any number of slides.
Yeah.
Resolve it. Yes. And we don't need any basic knowledge about this. Unlike coding.
Yeah. So now see, this site is ready. Basically, it has created these pages for my site automatically. So I can choose which pages I want and edit them. So if I say, let's say I want add page, I can add this. Let me just add three pages and say edit site. So it'll add these pages, create a website, which I can edit and add content, whatever I want.
Mm-hmm.
As simple as this. And if you are ready with your site, there's a button called publish. It'll just put it on the net. That's all.
How do you buy website domain, sir? I have no idea about that.
So, ma'am, there are a lot of sites called GoDaddy is there. Then you have even Wix allows for domain. There are many Indian sites also where you can purchase any domain.
Mm-hmm.
There is BigRock. GoDaddy is very popular where you can get. Now they even have Indian .in and .co.in available, which you can buy. But there are a lot of Indian sites also where you can buy. More or less, the price remains same across most of them. times they gave offer for the new. So you see, this website is created now. You see, all these web pages have been created, contact form, everything. So I just chose two pages and they have created it automatically. So now I can decide, all these are there on top. I can customize the content and everything and just go to top and say publish. That's it. And the good thing is you don't need to create a separate site for your mobile. Once it is created, it becomes mobile friendly also automatically. That's how it works.
Then it might be sounding silly, but I want to know, what is the difference between .co.in and .com?
So they are just different extensions, man, because what happens is people wanted to buy .com. .com is the most popular one, so it became a little expensive. So country-wise, domains were introduced. So .in typically means it's an Indian company. .us, like Zoom is zoom.us. So we know it's a US domain. So these country domains have been introduced a few years back to indicate which country the business belongs to. .co.in is just another extension, which is a cheaper version, because normally people use .com, .org, .in, which are more popular and they have a higher recall. So there is no difference otherwise. So you can go for, there are some sites which are .online. Then I have seen, there are so many extensions which are available. What matters is
.com is a commercial purpose. Commercial.
Yeah, normally commercial. So there are like .org is specifically used by organizations or academic institutions, like .edu is used by educational institutions. But if you have a business, you can go for even a .com. Even if you don't want to go for .com, you can go for .in, .online, .co.in, anything you can go for. It doesn't really matter for a business purposes. But when you're going for a specific purpose, like an educational institution or an NGO, or an organizational setup, then you can choose to go for a different one. So it clearly shows that you are into a different line. Otherwise, there is no difference as such in domain. But normally, .com are slightly higher priced as compared to the other ones.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you so much, all of you, for being patient and for all the questions, for clarifying doubts. If there is anything else, Dr. Shiv Kiran, you would want to talk about before we close?
This technology, when it comes to technology, it is always have a doubts throughout the journey.
So, absolutely.
It's very, sir, it's a wonderful having a session with you, and we need your support continuously. So your answering style is so patiently and so coolly and calmly. So that's why we need your phone number and contact numbers through Shivakiran garu. I requesting you. Thank you.
Sure. I'll pass on the details to him. Sure, not a problem. No issue at all. Be happy to help. Hello. Hello.
Sir, Shivakiran sir is in another call.
No problem. No
sir, your email ID, can you put it in chat, sir?
Sure. I'll give you my official email ID. You can write to me. Also give my contact number. You can reach out to me.
Thank you, sir.
I've also given my LinkedIn profile. In case anyone wants to connect with me on LinkedIn, please feel free. No problem.
What is that, sir? LinkedIn?
So LinkedIn is basically a professional networking site, which I think you should tell all your entrepreneurs to join. In fact, all of you should also join. It's primarily a network of all the professionals, any field. And you can share not only your credentials, you can connect with people. People find jobs through it. You can share a lot of wealth of information which you have, and you can learn from others also. So you can check this out and you can connect with me if you feel like. Thank you so much. Thank you for being such a patient and wonderful audience. Look forward to connecting with you all in future as well.
Sir, thank you, sir. I'm Dr. Chandramouli from AIC.
Yeah, Dr. Chandramouli.
So thank you very much, sir, for your patience and answering each and every question to thank all you. Our participants. And thank you, participants, for actively, it's a kind of discussion session I saw today. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, it's very nice of you for sharing your mobile number and email ID. Also, the platforms which Subramanian sir has explained is perfectly suitable for the startup ecosystem. Also, you can use few platforms to academic purposes and for development purpose as well. Okay, so you can give to your students so for practicing the tools also. Okay, so thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your session.
Thank you so much.
Looking forward to work with you, and all our startups also need your support. Thank you very much.